if you did not have the Norman Joe study?
I'd like to address that.
Yeah.
I think it would be a mistake not to have town's assistance in this area. And I'd like to know from what Steve said whether it's questionable that Norman Joe will be able to take this project on. Is that a question?
No, the question isn't whether or not they were able to. It's the question of when they could get it done.
Okay.
And they said, this is about 3 or 4 weeks ago, they said end of October, which could mean anywhere from now, you know, tomorrow through the 31st.
Doesn't give us very much time.
Yeah, I, for one planning board member who went on one sidewalk without that assistance, would hate to go on another one again. I think we need that assistance prior to us going on a sidewalk, so I'd like to see that planned into the process somehow.
Mm-hmm. And how do you feel about the workshop? Would it not be helpful to have this wetlands information at the workshop?
Madam Chairman, since I was the one that called for the wetland study at the last meeting, I think that it's important to realize that we have an applicant's data submitted.
Right.
And the purpose of our own wetland evaluation was because some of us saw some inconsistencies mm-hmm. between previously submitted data and the data that was presented here.
Right.
And yet, those inconsistencies were not of a gross nature. They were tweaks to the system and where the line should go on this side of the road or on that side of the road. So in terms of having data, we have it. In terms of having competent data from professionals, we have it. In terms of having an evaluation by our own staff hired by the town, we will have that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's something that we'll be looking at from a standpoint of, does it match? Do the lines need to change, and does that affect the design? I'm not sure that Norman Doe's report is critical prior to any meetings that we have of a technical basis or any workshops that we have.
Mm-hmm.
And I see the ability of a workshop, which the public would be invited to as well, is to give us some good quality time of a couple of hours to talk about an issue of significant import rather than half hours here and 45-minute periods here.
Right.
So I would encourage us to have that workshop session. I would encourage us to talk further about alternate A, and I would hope that the applicant just doesn't leave us here with the only ones having maps in the whole room, because I'm sure there are a number of people here that are interested in Broad Cove's future and this project's future as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I would hope we'd have a brief description of what alternative A is so that we set the stage for any future discussions.
We should probably do that next. Could we have a brief
yes, ma'am.
Discussion
glad to.
Of alternative
Could I just add one point? I agree with everything Mr. Tinsman said, but I would repeat, while it may not be important to have Norman Doe at the workshop, prior to the sidewalk, I would like to have them on board, have had a chance to do some review, and be with us when the sidewalk takes place. So if it looks like that's in jeopardy, I would like to hold on the sidewalk until we have them available for us.
May I ask a question, Madam Chairman?
Yes, sure.
It's the timing question. It looks to me as though the earliest, if you follow your normal procedure, the earliest you'd get to substantive review would be the 21st of November. I would hope that you would have your own consultant's report in by that time.
Oh, I would hope so, too.
I don't know what you're thinking about in terms of a sidewalk, however, in terms of the timing of that sidewalk. I haven't heard any discussion about that.
Well, I had hoped to... I thought it would be a good idea, I don't know how the rest of the planning board feels, to go on a sidewalk before we went to into workshop.
I understand.
Madam Chairman, we have in the past had more than one sidewalk.
That's
and on
correct.
On a large parcel of land such as this, it might even be very beneficial for us to do that.
I think that's a very good suggestion, and I had thought of it last week myself, thinking... We could just go on the first one to acquaint ourselves with the entire project and then focus more on the wetlands and priorities on a second sidewalk if the board is willing to go twice. What do you think about it, Dick?
Madam Chairman, Ivan Most suggested very strongly, and I concur, that for the formal sidewalk, we really need to have the plans down to the extent that the developer, the applicant, wants to propose them and present them. And we need our own evaluation of the wetland area, and I concur very strongly with Mr. Most on that. To the point of having an informal site walk before the application completeness, I think that would only serve us better.
Yep.
To be able to see the land form, but
mm-hmm.
I would consider that really an informal one where we're really
right.
not looking at land lot lines
Correct.
And where the road is going to be exactly with a center line plotted and all of the
mm-hmm.
things that we do during a formal sidewalk.
Right.
So if we do have an informal sidewalk, which I think could be a benefit, I would hope that we would also have a very formal sidewalk where we go out and walk the middle of the road and look at the lot lines and look at the Normando report and the eco-analyst report and
right.
all of those things and try to assemble them on paper and in our minds about where those roads and where those lots are going. So I still think that we would need a very formal one after application
completes. Absolutely. Good suggestion by the planning board. If you wanted to tentatively set up this informal site walk, would it be good on November 4th, just before the workshop? I have a wedding that day, a very important wedding at 11 o'clock, but I could get into my wedding clothes and go to the site walk. I've done that before.
I'll be out of town.
We've noticed.
I'll be out of town at 4.
You would be out of town. Anybody else? How does that look to you?
It's okay with me. How about the last Saturday in October?
That's the 28th.
I have to go to a wedding that day.
I'm going to another wedding that day, too, and I can't miss it.
Yeah, that's
it's
right.
A niece.
That's right.
Well, I have an unexciting social calendar. I'm looking for
Well, then, could we tentatively set
However,
it for...
However, I don't see why we couldn't if we went in early in the morning, 8:30.
That's right. If 8:30 would be all right, then November 4th?
Either way.
November 4th would be better for me.
Okay, it would be much better for me. And if you did it at 8:30, I could still go to the wedding. We'll just spend a few hours. Would that be convenient for you, Mr. Kennedy?
You want the transportation?
Oh, no, that's all right. We walk.
Really, if it's raining or something like that, you can drive through a lot of the site.
Okay. Well, we'll just meet you where? By Two Lights Road? By the farmhouse?
Uh-huh.
8:30. Okay. And on the workshop, Steve, did you mention that we had to make a report to the town council on January 1st or whatever?
In January, early February.
Yeah.
Is this on affordable housing? That's
right.
February, isn't it?
Oh, because that was a February 1st.
Well, I think the way we agreed, we were going to have a workshop on affordable housing in December and January and report in February.
Okay.
And then wasn't there a mobile home?
One thing that
study.
I think, or I might suggest to the board in terms of the workshop is to at least get going on the mobile home park side of things just to acquaint yourself with the requirements of the legislation. That's something I suggested to the chairperson. And so you might want to reserve half hour, three quarters of an hour of the workshop at the beginning just to at least broach that topic.
So if we began our workshop at 7, this is such a housekeeping session, dear me. If we began our workshop at 7, would it be convenient for you to come at 7:30? Very good. Very good. So now that we have all of that housekeeping
Madam Chairman, where
would
the workshop be?
Yes.
At 7:30.
Oh,
on
right,
the 7th.
Right down in our usual place,
cafeteria.
Downstairs
okay.
in the cafeteria. Okay? So now I assume that you will tell us about any minor changes for the public who has come.
Scott Decker will review alternate A for you.
Great. Thank you.
Madam Chairman, we're perhaps a little ill-prepared. We weren't really prepared to make a presentation on alternate A. We might have to borrow one of your plans.
Well, it would just, it's just a short presentation, too. We've seen the plans, but for the people who have come out in the rain, I think it would be
okay.
nice to just explain it.
very generally, what it...
Let me...
Generally, what the alternative plan does for us is that the original submitted plan shows the road from Two Lights Road coming through the site along the edge of the mapped wetland area and in fact through a short stretch of the wetland at this location and through to Winding Way. The alternate A plan shows this road moving up and intersecting with Hunts Point Road Extension in this fashion. And what that does is eliminates the passage through the wetland of the main drive. And the through road is the connection onto Hunts Point Road. Also down here at Winding Way, we would have a private drive, which would come up into a fairly large lot here, this lot number 6. The original plan showed the phase one area having 8 lots. The alternative plan has 6 lots. And that's basically the change to the phase one area. Phase two has a small change in the length of the cul-de-sac here at Heritage Court, and that would require some sort of waiver on the frontage around this cul-de-sac. The ordinance requires a couple hundred feet around a cul-de-sac. We're showing something a little less than that on that cul-de-sac. But very briefly, that is the change.
Okay, any questions from the planning board? Thank you, Mr. Decker. Any questions at this time?
Madam Chairman, no questions. One of the issues that came up the first planning board meeting was the extent to which wetlands were being disturbed by a fairly long road. Mm-hmm. This alternate A addresses those concerns in a good way. There are now other questions of traffic and where the cars are going and how many there are and a whole bunch of issues like that.
And intersections, etc.
Yes.
All of which can be discussed at a workshop.
Could you just explain once again how you are you going to access lots 4 and 5? I missed that.
Yes, that would be a private drive off from the main access road. There is currently a very narrow dirt road that crosses the wetland, and we would intend to utilize that road as part of a private drive up to lots 4 and 5.
So it'll still be crossing the wetlands with a private drive.
Yes, utilizing the same road that's there now.
Well, let's get on then. You have no other comments, Mr. Decker?
No.
Thank you. Let's get on then with the issue of the completeness of this application. Steve, do you want to start?
I think all the board members at least have received previously a draft copy of the memo and an earlier version of the checklist. In your package, when your materials this evening, there was an updated list, both an updated checklist as well as an updated version of the memo that covers some points that various planning board members discussed with me as I requested, and also there's one point in there that was brought up after discussion with the town attorney. If you want, I can go through all these items, or I can go through the recent changes, whatever the board wishes.
Whatever you think best.
Well, since I think most people directly affected by this have gone through the memo at least once, what I think I'll do is then focus in on the new areas so you can see where the changes are. and I'm going to flip back and forth between checklist and the memo. There have been two additions made, and they're both related. On the current memo, there's a new H, which deals with deed restriction descriptions. And also on the second page at the very end, I've added a question regarding evidence of right, title, and interest in the property to be reviewed. And you can see that those are also have been changed on the checklist. And those would be items 13B, was changed from okay, oh, sorry, yes, 13B was changed from an okay to partial. And at the very end of the checklist, the evidence of right, title, and interest was changed from okay to partial.
Oh, of course.
You can have a draft copy, then we'll sign the...
Yeah, and we will sign one. And Have you seen the most recent letter from the town engineer, dated October 6th? You do not have a copy of that? Well, it's a rather...
That's the last one.
It's a rather lengthy letter. I can't read it to you. This is his second report, which...
Don't have an extra one.
He doesn't have an extra, but I'm sure that you will receive one. I think it would be very helpful to you. It has to do with more detailed hydrogeologic studies, etc., absorption beds, runoff rate, downstream impacts, etc., for three pages. So, Steve, you will make sure that they get this very important information, right? Okay.
Just so the board knows, it's... Until things change, it's general policy not to send out to the applicants ahead of time materials from the town attorney, town engineer, what have you, unless they're specifically requested. So I think that's one reason why they may not have it, although I thought the applicant did have a copy. In terms of some other changes to the completeness memo and checklist, there was a slight word change on the third line of E regarding the sidewalk issue. And on the second page of the memo, another item was added regarding under L, the issue of location of threatened or endangered plant species other than in the wetlands to be preserved. That phrase was added. I talked about P on the second page of the memo, and then on the last paragraph of the memo, the first sentence, the statements contained above address only the minimum level of data required to determine whether or not the application has included data that addresses the subdivision ordinance's submission requirements, is a new sentence. Now, everything else is the same as you saw before.
Any questions or discussion on the application completeness of this project?
No, Madam Chairman, other than to concur with the letter, I think it was very well drafted and appropriately documented.
Good. And do I, yes?
Madam Chairman, I'd say there's a suggested motion then that could be read, and once that was read, then what I anticipate happening then was that the planning board chairperson could then sign the memo, we could make a copy, and give a copy to the applicant. So the procedures of the ordinance would be followed.
As soon as I am authorized by the rest of the planning board, I will sign. Do I hear a motion?
I would make a motion. Be it ordered that the preliminary plan application of the Greater Portland Development Group, Inc. for the Highlands at Broad Cove, a proposed 24-lot subdivision located off Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Channel View Road, and Two Lights Road is deemed to be incomplete in accordance with Section 16-2-4 and Appendix B of the Subdivision Ordinance the application completeness checklist and memo, both dated 10/17/89, and the facts presented.
Thank you. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, I will call for a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? It's unanimous. I will sign this and turn it over.
Madam Chairman, I don't want to belabor the point, but we did receive a lot of mail from people who are residents in the area.
Yes.
And it may be worthwhile for either you or Steve to review procedure in this case and what this vote means and what subsequent votes will mean in terms of the steps involved in this process. I think some people may have been putting more importance on this completeness or incompleteness
right.
vote than they may think is there.
Yes.
So it may be worth reviewing it for the people that are here and other people who might be listening.
Yeah, if we could do that briefly. I had thought about that today. It was such a lengthy meeting that I thought perhaps one of the better times to do it would be at a public hearing, should one occur. But Steve, would you like to just briefly explain to the people who have come out in the rain exactly what has
sure.
happened here?
In a nutshell, if there is such a thing, the planning board, before it acts on the substance of an application, goes through the application completeness process to make sure that all the information that minimally should be submitted for the board to make a decision has been done so by the applicant. And at this point in time, the planning board's decision, in essence, states that there's some additional material needs to be submitted before the planning board can really move on the substance. Once the application is determined to be complete by the board, within 30 days of that meeting, there will be a public hearing set. And at that time, there'll be a public notice sent out to all appropriate abutters and nearby property owners regarding that. And it's at that public hearing where any and all people who would like to will be able to make a public comment regarding the proposal.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Steve. Well, we thank you all for coming out in the rain, and thank you.
Madam Chairman?
I have signed that. Yeah.
One more issue. I just want to clarify it for my benefit.
Mm-hmm.
Getting back to the issue of the submission deadline and when the applicant can submit materials, I just want to make sure it's clear, to me at least, that the original submission deadline of November 3rd will stand in terms of my review for completeness.
Yeah.
But that after, and so anything submitted after that will not be considered by myself to be included as part of that review, but that if the applicant wishes to submit something after November 7th, the workshop date, they can do that up till Friday, November 10th, so that they'll have time to get into the planning board packet, which should go out early the next week. I just wondered, is that?
Sounds fair enough to
is
me.
Is that clear and sound
yeah.
fair?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank
I'll make
you,
a copy
Steve.
Of this for the applicant.
Thank you very much. Okay, the planning board wish to take a few moments break before we go on to the last item on our agenda?
No.
No? You'd like to just keep going?
I think we're getting late.
Okay. Well, welcome back, Mr. Boxer. We'll wait until our planner returns before we go on to the next item.
Madam Chairman, point yes. of information. I take it we had two items on the agenda, application completeness and preliminary plan review. We did, I guess, preliminary plan review as part of our completeness thought.
Yeah.
So is that how we did this?
I don't know. I'm a little mixed up.
There's no vote required for preliminary
no.
plan review, so okay.
No. I think that could just be sort of stricken as part of that. OK. Okay, are we, have you changed the tape, Steve? Steve's job is not only intellectual, it's physical. There's a lot of running around. Okay. All set. The next item on the agenda, and we are sorry that we are running a bit late, is Mr. Richard Davis of Cottage Farms Road, a request for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration, section 19-3-9.
Madam Chair?
Yes?
Madam Chairperson?
Yes?
I understand that that our attorney is here, that there's some litigation involving this parcel.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm correct, I think it would be appropriate to go into executive session and have him advise us on the litigation, the implications of what we do here tonight with relation to that litigation.
Mm-hmm. Do you move?
Is this project related to the litigation, Tom?
Yes, it is.
Then I would move that we have a brief executive session.
Okay. Is there a second to Dan's motion? Any discussion? All in favor? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Just to explain to the public, no decisions are made in executive session, and we will just be getting some advice and information, and we will return shortly. We will be taking a short break.
About 300 piles of fill which had been deposited on this land, I believe, by a contractor about 15 years ago. Might have been 10 years ago. I remember when it was put there, but I can't remember when. And the reason I wanted to level that land was that trees were growing out of the piles. They were growing in all different directions, and you could hardly walk over it. And so, anyway, I started to level those piles, which were in this area, right here. And there were some down in here too, but most of them were in here. There weren't any over in here. And so anyway, I proceeded to level those. I also did some leveling over in where the line is. Now, the town's wetland map showed wetlands coming up in to probably something like this, across here. And so as far as leveling the piles were shown in an area on the wetland map that, was ostensibly in a wetland. So anyway, to make a long story short, the town hired a soil scientist, and I hired a soil scientist, and they went out there, and they dug test pits, and they did all the things that soil scientists are supposed to do to determine what soil is. And they determined collectively that this is what the soil is, and this is what the boundaries are of the soil. The soil scientist that I engaged was Mr. Albert Frick, who is here with me now. So that's the history of what happened there. I've owned the property for about 4 years. My plan, when I started doing this, was to level the land and plant rye. That was my, and that's still my basic plan. Now, I sent a letter to the planning board on the date of October 4, 1989.
Right, I'm looking at that right now.
And I'm requesting three things of the planning board. One is that the board approve this plan, which I think has the approval of at least the soil scientist for myself and the town. And then, number two, to request the board to recommend to the town council that the wetland map for the town be changed to reflect what you see on this plan.
Well, Mr. Davis, on number two, we can't possibly do that because we don't have the authority to change the wetlands map. Only the town council has that authority. So you go on. I just wanted to clarify that.
No, I understand that. But what I'm asking is that you recommend to the council that they change the map to reflect what's here.
We don't do that unless it is requested that we do a study for the council. It would be presumptuous of us to do that. But go on, please, with number three. And then you say to request the planning board to allow me to continue leveling. Right?
Well, on number two, also, you know, my reason for that is that I don't want to go through, you know, an application process, you know, every time I want to do something, you know, with this land. I mean, that's the whole reason I'm doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And third is to request the planning board, you know, to allow me to continue with this leveling that I'm doing. And I plan to do it on all the land except what's designated as wetland. And my intention is to plant rye when I'm done. I think that's about it. I thought the town attorney said at some point that there'd be no big problem in the board recommending to the council that the map be changed. I realize that you can't change it.
No, we don't have the authority. Only our elected officials do. Dan, would you like to say something?
Yeah, I think we have a couple problems here, Mr. Davis. You don't want to have to keep getting approval for something that you think shouldn't require approval because you don't believe it's a wetland to start with. I take it that's one of your objections. We don't have much choice because it shows on our official map as a wetland. As you know from the ordinances, the wetlands map is adopted by the town council. And to me, we really don't have any authority to do any of the things you're asking us to do, short of, if you're willing to say, and I don't think you are, and I don't expect you to, that your position is that you're biting your tongue, so to speak, and you're not going to argue that it's not a wetland, and you want this treated as a wetland, and you're willing to go through the application process, which it sounds like you don't want to do. You want us to agree with you that it's erroneously denominated a wetland. And first of all, before we did that, if we had some jurisdiction here, we'd want to hear from these experts. The towns, and I have a lot of questions as to whether something that is filled now but previously may have been a wetland can be a wetland, a lot of legal questions that I have. But I don't think we get to those because I really think that the town has to change that, the town council, before we can do anything. If they ask us to give them a recommendation, then I guess I would tell them we need to have some sort of a full-blown proceeding, and if they ask us, we'll do it. But until that time, it seems to me the town has to change that zoning ordinance or that wetlands map, or we have to treat it as a wetland.
Well, theoretically, the town might not change the map for 10 years. So are you saying for the next 10 years I can't utilize this land because the map is wrong?
I'm saying that if you came before me as a planning board member and said, I want you to approve something because it's not really a wetland, I tell you that until the town council tells me that it's not a wetland, you have to go through a wetlands approval process.
Well, what am I doing here now? I mean, I have my soil engineer here. We prepared the plan. Owen Haskell did the engineering. He's formerly the town engineer. I mean, we've taken tests, boring.
You've asked us to make a decision based on the fact that this land is erroneously shown on the town wetland map. And we can't do that. We can't say that the town council was wrong. They have to say they were wrong.
Is this how you want to leave this? I mean, I understood Mr. Leahy's letter on the first page, the last paragraph. It certainly was mapped as a wetland. It is clear. Got the wrong paragraph. Excuse me. On the second page, the last paragraph,
It would be cleaner if the official wetland map was amended, but the planning board cannot amend the map. It can only recommend the town council to do so. On the other hand, it would be putting form above substance if the planning board were to approve the after-the-fact alteration upon finding that, in fact, it was not a wetland. I don't, you know, to me, it's pretty clear, but if it's a problem with the board, then, you know, then I might as well...
Tom, would you like to address this?
Well, I think I agree with what...
Perhaps you could tell the public who you are, introduce yourself.
I'm Tom Leahy, I'm the town attorney. This matter has a long history, which I think is perhaps relevant to what we're getting into right now. The problem is we have an after-the-fact situation. That's the first problem. The second problem then is, well, what do you do if you're a citizen and you feel that the map is wrong? There's an official map, and ordinance says thou shall not alter the wetlands as mapped on that official map. So what do you do? I think what we're doing here is struggling to figure out which is the best course of action. As I hear Dan Boxer translating that a little further, what he's saying is, as a member of the planning board, he's not ready to recommend to the council a change of map because he would want to have experts in wetlands advise him, not only Mr. Davis, but other experts advise him that this is wrong and that the map that hangs in the town hall here is wrong and it should be corrected to reflect what is shown on this map, and that you don't just do it, you get input, and he's not ready to do it. Secondly, although this board can initiate changes to the ordinance, that it's not clear, it can to the wetlands map, it can to the wetlands provisions, but not to the wetlands map. That's unclear, so why should you take your time here and do it that way? The council has to make the change. This applicant has the right to go to the council or ask for the change. If you're asked for your opinion, you'll give it based upon whatever's presented to you at the time. I think that's the response I'm hearing in regard to recommendation of a change to the map. The first question is, I think presented by Mr. Davis's application, is kind of the after-the-fact approval of what has occurred. And I guess the stumbling block is that there's an application pending. He asked what he's doing here, and he's here to have it approved. But what he has done, if I hear Mr. Boxer, at least from this one perspective, is he stopped short. He has said, well, here's my wetlands alteration permit application. Here's my soil scientist report. It's not a wetland. I stop. And I guess what I hear Mr. Boxer saying is if you want a permit from us, then you have to proceed through the rest of the procedures. You have to then take Mr. Frick's report, if you will, act as if it's a wetland and say why it complies with all the standards, which may not be difficult if it's not a wetland. That's my own personal opinion, not the legal position, but it may not be difficult to meet the standards if you're not a wetland. But I think what I hear Dan saying, Mr. Boxer saying, is that if you're going to give a permit, you have to go through the procedures, and we've kind of stopped at one point. If you've got a statement required, it's submitted and stops there. It does not then go and say how it meets the terms. So I think when we said bite, I think Dan used the term, if you want to bite your tongue and not stop at the wetlands, but rather proceed and tell the planning board why this activity shall not violate or put in a positive sense, would allow this board to make a positive finding that the alteration meets these various criteria, and there's six of them. I think, Dick, that's what I hear, that at least one member has said, take the next step and if you want to, take the next step and present it, because that's the only thing they can do, is act upon an application, go through the procedures, and based upon your expert, do you meet those criteria or not? And you get denied or approved. Or don't stop the planning board, go to the council and have the map changed, and maybe they won't need those criteria. They'll just say, we take the map and we
we'll color our map accordingly and amend it as of whenever they approve it. Again, I know there's wetlands ordinance change and map change going on. I suspect they're spending a lot of time on it. To the extent they're looking at a map, they should look at these findings perhaps. But I guess that's the quandary the board finds itself in. I'm, again, not speaking for the board. I wasn't endorsing Mr. Davis' application. I'm trying to put in perspective in my letter, and I am right now, just the alternatives. So, but that's the way I see it. And again, I'm paraphrasing Dan, probably take a long time doing it, but I believe that that's what Mr. Boxer is saying. You either go to the council, and if they want our recommendation, it'll come to us, or go through the rest of the provisions, and if you meet the criteria, you get your permit. If you don't, you don't.
Well, Tom, have you got the criteria?
Yep.
No, I don't have too much trouble with most of what Tom said, but I will take issue with the first thing he said, and that is an after-the-fact permit. And my position is that whatever I have done to that land did not require a permit, and if I return to the land and continue what I was doing, it will not require a permit. And I don't have any intention of going through a long process with the planning board or with the council. I mean, I'm perfectly willing, I have my soil scientist here, and I'm perfectly willing to go through the criteria and see if we meet it. Although, to me, I don't understand it, because I'm going through a criteria for a wetland when the scientists for the town and my own scientists both agree that it's not a wetland. But if you want me to do that, I'll do it, because I'd like to have this resolved, and I'd like to have it resolved tonight. I mean, I've tried to cooperate with the town, and with the town attorney, and everyone else. And I'm here because of the suggestion of the town. And now I'm being told to go to the council or some other place. And, you know,
we don't have authority to change.
You can recommend to the council
the map.
I understand that, but you can recommend to the council. But if what I'd like to do, if you want me to do it, I'm not going to take up your time, it's late. If you want me to go through, I'll have the soil scientist go through the criteria here. If not, then just turn it down. Just turn me down, so at least I'll know where I stand.
We wouldn't even know what we were turning down.
Well, you told me. The town told me to come here.
Well, we didn't tell you to come here, and I appreciate your dilemma, but we can only do the two things that Tom mentioned, and we can't act on this tonight. If you're going to ask us for a wetlands alteration application, as I read the ordinance, it's supposed to be a public hearing, and we're supposed to get all the application information. We just can't stand up here and sort of run through the things. You can do it, but we can't legally give you what you want tonight, even if you met the burden.
What do you recommend?
Anyone else on the planning board have anything input on this?
I don't think we have something we can act on, so I don't think there's any reason for input
right
at this point.
Then do I hear a motion on this?
I've got to think of what it would be.
Yeah.
Let me just take a look at the application here. I guess my motion would be that because the planning board does not have the authority to alter the wetlands map as requested, or to base a decision on the erroneous mapping, then I would move that this board not take any action on what it is that's requested of us, which is a little unclear to me tonight.
Is it an assumption to base it on erroneous mapping?
We're being asked to base an assumption on the fact that it's an erroneous map, and I think that that's as far beyond our jurisdiction as changing the map, making that assumption. I think it's up to the planning board. I mean, up to the council that has to decide whether they made an error. We can't decide they made an error. So I guess my motion is simply that we
can't act on what I interpret this request to be because we don't have the authority to do so.
Is there a second to that?
Madam Chairman, before I second that, because I agree in principle with what
right.
Mr. Boxer is saying.
It's a very confusing.
Well, it's an interesting issue that we
indeed.
Don't face every day, fortunately.
Mm-hmm.
There are two, Dan has appropriately stated as Mr. Leahy, our attorney, that there are two courses of action that could occur. One is mm-hmm. to change the wetlands map, which we can't do, and that's a
right.
council activity.
It's not within our authority.
And I don't hear a lot of desire on the part of the planning board to go out and recommend to the town council that that map be changed, but the applicant can certainly do that. Second issue is a wetlands permit application, which we do issue by ordinance, and
mm-hmm.
there are a number of criteria that have to be followed in order for us to be able to act on that. We have a checklist of our wetland alteration permit submission checklist. There are some things there that are incomplete, and I think Mr. Leahy pointed out that the application was initiated and it stopped with, this is not a wetland, so nothing
mm-hmm.
else matters. I wonder, and I'll beg the question, whether if we have an appropriate application before us, whether it's complete or incomplete, I would suggest that it may be incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the remedies for that is for the applicant to prepare an application, come before the board, and treat it as a wetland alteration.
Right.
With all of the technical data about effects on adjacent pieces of land, which this has stopped short of doing.
Mm-hmm.
That's one area. So I wonder if our motion should be, and I just beg the question, I don't know what the answer is, that this is an incomplete application for wetland alteration
mm-hmm.
and leave it at that point.
Mm-hmm. So in other
words, I would second that because really that's what has come before us is an application for wetlands. At least that's what I see. And so we can address it in that sense, and it's incomplete. And then if the applicant wants to come back with a complete application, it's up to him.
And just ignore the request that we alter the land designated as a wetland on the town map?
Wouldn't that be up to the applicant to take
yeah,
that?
I'm perfectly happy to,
mm-hmm.
I think really need to do both, and one of them is easier to do than the other. We can just do nothing on the alteration thing and do.
Or we can table it. On the basis that you've suggested, there may be two motions. I don't know.
But I think we can just do nothing.
Right.
I'll withdraw my motion, and Dick can have his motion.
I agree with Dick. I don't see how the first two things we can do. As far as I can see, how we can do anything here is to just go through the steps of a wetlands alteration permit and a complete application. Once it's complete, we'll go do the site walk, we'll have the public hearing, and then based on everything that we get, just like anybody else, you either get it or you don't. But based on the information.
But if Mr. Davis does not have his mapping changed,
if he does,
every time he wants to do anything there, he will have the problem, and Mr. Davis doesn't feel that that his land is a wetlands, and he does not feel that he needs to.
Well,
then the
alternate is to go to the town council and get the map changed.
Right, so we're right back where we started.
As long as Mr. Davis is before us, it's for a wetlands application. That's all he can be before us for. That's all we can act on, and I agree with Dick's motion. I would second it.
Okay. Any further discussion? Yes?
Madam Chairman, I just might be a good time to ask the applicant what he's anticipating doing. Was he in fact applying for a wetlands alteration permit or not? Before you act upon
mm-hmm.
that, you might want to just clarify from the applicant what he was trying to do. If he wasn't applying for a wetlands alteration permit after all, that was my understanding. If he wasn't, and I think everybody's understanding, if he wasn't, you don't even have to vote on that issue. So I think you may want to ask the applicant what he really proposed to do on wetlands alteration and maybe also what he's anticipating to do in the future.
Well, except Steve, what we have,
probably doesn't know.
Except what we have in writing in front of us is an application for a wetlands permit. That's what we have in front of us. And so I think we have to dispose of that before we do anything else. And that's what Dick's motion does.
Okay, if it's clear in your mind, so that's what you have.
That's what the paperwork says.
Yes, Mr. Davis.
I said in my letter. I sent a letter to the planning board.
and I ask for three things. Now, how you interpret those, you know, is up to you. Apparently, you interpret them differently than I do. The third one, I did ask for permission to continue doing what I'm doing. Now, if that, if you want to call it a wetlands alteration permit, then you can, you can. I mean, I don't call it that because it's not wetland.
Well, you don't, but it's a mapped wetland.
Yeah, well, the map is wrong.
But the map has not been changed. It's a mapped wetland. So we have to act on it as a wetland.
If you act on it, that's up to you. If you want to, if that's what you want to call it.
It's not up to us.
That's not what I, what I applied for is what I put in the letter, the three requests.
But your first request is an application to alter land, and you put parentheses, non-wetland. That's your designation,
right.
But it isn't ours,
that's
delineated
right.
as a wetland on 10.
Right.
So
right.
It, to me, that would imply perhaps an application for a wetland permit.
But it doesn't to me.
Madam Chairman.
Could we all start going through the chair? This is, you know, words are flying back and forth. Steve, I will recognize you.
Madam Chairman, just so I know, Mr. Davis and I have had this discussion more than once, and that's why I wanted to raise the issue. When he and I talked, I pretty much stated that if he wanted to come before the board, the way to do it would be to apply for a wetlands alteration permit. Otherwise, it would be difficult for the board to take any action. We went back and forth. He submitted materials, and I thought the understanding was that he might be leaning towards that route. I wasn't sure, and he didn't come right out and say it. So that's why I raised the issue now, just to make sure that it's clear in your mind. You may want to ask the town attorney, you know, at some point, if you can't reach an agreement, where to proceed. But I think, at least as far as I read it, if he's not applying for a wetlands alteration permit, and he didn't state that,
we have no business.
And you're not willing, then and you don't want to recommend to the town council, you maybe at the end of the discussion. Probably something you want to discuss and review with the town attorney. But
Madam Chairman, and before Tom speaks,
yes.
and while he's coming up,
you may
speak. Thank you. I think that the issues that Steve raises are very appropriate and very accurate. I'm glad you asked that question because the assumption was that there was an application before us and that it was properly before us as something that we could deal with.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it was an item on the agenda. Mr. Davis is saying that this is not a wetlands application, then we have no basis for action other than a request that we recommend to the town council that the wetland map be changed. And I, as one member, am unwilling to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to initiate an action to change a map. The applicant can do that. That's a remedy that he has. He should do that. I think the planning board will be asked for its comments at some point. And sitting as an advisory group in that case to the council, we would want to be able to look at the facts presented at that time and then make our recommendation to the town council as its advisor.
Correct. Good. Tom?
Well, I think, you know, this is evidencing, and I'm sure some of the people sitting here are just wondering what all these people are doing talking about this, because it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And the ordinance just doesn't address the problem that's presented to you, and I will give the benefit of doubt to Mr. Davis that he's trying to meet the substance of the ordinance. He has a problem because his position is that it's not a wetland. There is nothing in the wetlands alteration provisions that give you the right or the power to tell them, you know, it's not a wetland, go home. You know, you don't need a permit, go home. Go do what you want. There's nothing. And so, you know, you're in between two different sections. He either has to go through the motions, the procedures, and the submissions of it being a wetlands alteration, and he's seeking your permit after the fact to do so. Or he goes to the council and gets a map change.
Right.
I think, you know, the more we talk about this, I think it's as simple as that. You know, and I know he feels that it's not a wetland, but I think he's what he's doing is he feels that way, but you don't have a procedure to deal with that.
Mm-mm.
And the choices are not ours.
No.
Well, that's what I'm saying. The ordinance doesn't deal with it. It doesn't give you the right to deal with it. So I understand his frustration, but I don't think that necessarily creates something. I mean, I for one, would like to see that. I'd like to see the... if it's not a wetland, and if you concur, or if the council concurs, fine. But if it's you, it's going to be through this alteration permit procedure. If it's a council, it's a totally different, it's really the map. It's really, these aren't wetlands. They don't even look at these criteria. It's either wetlands or it's not, and they map accordingly. So, I mean, it's a different procedure before each group. I think some of us getting hung up is just what he's asking for. But I think it's either going to be, you know, Fisher file, it's either he's going to go through that process or not, is the way I see it. Maybe he needs time to reflect, and maybe Mr. Tinsman's response is the correct one, which is, if you don't have anything before you which goes through the criteria, then your application is incomplete. If he wishes to complete it, so be it. If he doesn't, you don't have anything before you except a recommendation to the council. You can rule on that. You can say what you want. I've heard some people say they don't want to do that. If he wants to initiate a map change and if the council wants your recommendation, you respond. I mean, I think the course is pretty clear what you can do now.
Thank you. Any other comments? There is no need to make a motion, or
there is,
or maybe
we will have to move something.
Okay.
And it might be a motion to table, or it might be a motion to deem it an incomplete application.
Mm-hmm. Take your choice.
I'd make a motion
if the applicant has said, though, that he does not have a wetlands application before us.
Then we.
Do we need to do anything? I think it's clear on the record. I understand why he's doing it. He's got a legal position he wants to protect. But if he says this is not a wetlands application, I'm not sure we need to say it's incomplete.
That's right. Okay. So motion to table would be on order, I would expect.
Yeah.
So moved. Do I hear it? Second?
Second.
All in favor? Say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Well, Mr. Davis, I wish you well in your quest.
How long is this table for?
I don't know, till you come back again with something that we have the authority to deal with. It's going to be your decision. Thank you, Mr. Davis. And I thank all of you for coming to the planning board meeting, and good night. Thank you. Thank you.